everyone, and welcome to Eyes On Rio, a collaborative effort between Soccer Yanks and Across the Pond Radio. I am your host today, Dan from the Soccer Yanks. You may or may not know who I am. With me, I have two glorious members of Across the Pond Radio, Jacob and Shay. Say
Howdy.
Hello, gentlemen.
Howdy.
How you doing?
And joining me from the Soccer Yanks camp, I've got Jay, also known as Rescinded Red.
How are you guys?
So, the World Cup is crashing down upon us in a few weeks. It's gonna wreck our social lives, ruin our marriages, destroy our relationships, but it's gonna be amazing.
Definitely will be. I probably shouldn't admit it on air, but I can get stream World Cup games from my desk at work in a nice, sick two-screen setup. So hopefully, none of my coworkers listen.
I'm winking at you right now. Today, I think we've got two groups we're gonna dissect and divulge into, groups B and groups E. And I think group B is a very sexy, sexy group.
Oh, wow.
I mean, soccer-wise, of course. It's Spain, Chile, the Netherlands, and Australia. Wow.
Yeah.
That's a pretty impressive group. Right off the bat, the current title holder, Spain, coming back for more.
Yeah, that first match, Spain versus Netherlands, I think is so pivotal for the group. And just in general, my initial thought when looking at the draw was, you know, the stakes are so high for this group, given that, you know, the likely second place finisher could be a very top quality team and then have to end up playing Brazil. So the imperative is getting first in this game. And then to top it off, you know, Spain versus Netherlands to kick it all off can really send these two campaigns in very, very different directions.
Jay, you are a Spaniard. What's your take here?
Well, it's definitely interesting because it's the last run of the old guard. I mean, this is a team that's going to be, you know, they've been together since the 2008 Euros. And I mean, almost being six or seven players from their starting core is their last go around. Specifically for Xavi, as 32, being in the core and now might not even get any playing time. It'd be interesting how they integrate the old guard and then the new guys who are not as well versed in tiki-taka style, but are still immensely talented.
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, that tiki-taka style takes a tremendous amount of energy and work rate. And I can't probably so cliche to say this, but, you know, the continental teams, European continental teams, tend to not fare well, you know, in South America historically. And when you factor in the age and the amount of mileage on that team, I think you're completely right. Some of these harsh weather conditions and the heat may be too much.
No, I completely agree, Jacob. And it's going to be crazy to see because Chile is a team that, they haven't, you know, till recently they haven't made a lot of noise, but this is their second World Cup consecutively. You know, they're in South, you know, they're playing in their home continent. They look good in qualification. And, you know, I'm sure no one expects any other team but Spain and Netherlands to make it past this group, right?
No, but, I think Chile.
Nope. Well, I got Chile also.
Okay, yeah. Well, I was going to say, but that's the thing, though. It's going to be interesting to see because Chile can make some noise. You know, I want to put him going ahead. I just don't know who I'm going to sacrifice out of the two.
To bring it back to Spain, I got a lot to say about Chile as well. But Spain, everything that we're talking about the core and playing tiki-taka and, you know, not faring well in South America and the weather. I mean, Vincent Del Bosque, he's got to know this stuff too. I can only imagine that since a big chunk of their new players are playing for the Madrid teams that play a different style of football, you've got to imagine that he's going to try to give the tiki-taka a break, especially since a lot of teams are expecting that, and maybe go a little bit more direct, maybe go a little bit more counterattack. He's got the players to do it. I think that would be, if he could do that, would give Spain the best chance. Because if they're going to play that tiki-taka, everybody knows they're going to do it. They're going to set up the bus.
Isn't it so dependent on the status of Diego Costa? I mean, you have to throw that out there. Obviously undergoing that sort of, you know, crazy witch doctor treatment with placenta or God knows what type of stuff this woman is putting in. But, I mean, that's the real determining factor. You can't play Route 1 without that guy. And they're, since, you know, he's so strong, but they've invested so much in him. Without him, I'm left kind of questioning on what type of lineup they'll field. And, you know, I mean, I think it's only a grade one hamstring play, a strain or tear or whatever. So he's clearly going to be back. But, I mean, where do you guys see them, you know, making adjustments in the front line there?
They asked for a one-time change for Messi.
Yeah, right.
Well, they're going to have to rely on Torres.
Well, yeah, Torres, and they have Negredo, but Negredo really hasn't got a lot of run out. But he does love Torres, DeBosco. He's a fan of Torres. He has a great relationship with him. And I think if it's between Torres and anybody else other than Costa, Torres is making that group. I mean, excluding Pedro, who's definitely making it, but he's more of a midfielder anyway.
I'm just not terribly convinced by that. That's why I think if you look at sort of players such as, well, let's see how his fitness turns out. But I think it's very tough whenever you have a player who has an injury ahead of the World Cup or a major tournament. And let's say you take him on and you know he won't be fit for the first game, but you could have him for the second or third game. I mean, that's always incredibly problematic to hope that that player will turn up. And I just look at the prime example of Wayne Rooney in the metatarsal injury, you know, knowing he will be fit, but maybe not sure when or at what percentage. And he's really, you know, he obviously struggled in 2010, so... I think that's just the main thing we have to notice. But lineup wise, how do you guys expect them to line up? Let's say with Diego Costa and without.
With Diego Costa, I think they're going with a 4-2-3-1, and Pedro on the left. They're gonna see. I don't know if they're gonna go with both Xavi Alonso and Busquets as having two destroyers out there. They might put in Martinez, but I think Martinez might just be there just as a backup for the center back position, which is their weakest point. But I don't see Xavi in the starting lineup right away. If he does, it's one game. It's going to be Ernesto, Pedro, and Cesc, and then it's either going to be if they want to play a winger, they're going to play Juan Fan on the right as the fullback. If they don't play Juan Fan, they're going to play either Navas as a pure winger to open up the right side, or they can play Silva, who's just been incredible the last 2 years anyway.
Yeah, I see it being similar to Barcelona's lineup in just the formation, like, you know, three in the middle, you know, with like Busquets probably holding the furthest back. The forward question was a good question because I'm not sure who they're going to put up top, you know, but. Let's just say it's Negredo and Costa's on the wing, or if Costa's not healthy, whatever, then it'll be Silva, Iniesta, you know, Fabregas in the middle. They've typically gone with the same. I mean, they're not teams to really change it up. They've typically gone with the same lineup consecutively the last couple, you know, the World Cup and the Euros. So I'm expecting the same thing.
Can those legs, they're a little bit older, that core, can they keep up in the heat? You know, I agree. They do play a lot of the same guys. I think almost to the detriment of the development of the younger guys.
Yeah.
Is the Xavi, Iniesta, Alonso, you know, are these guys all going to be able to play every single match?
Well, this guy's only 25, so he can hang around. And Fess is 27. And a lot of other guys, I mean, unfortunately, I don't think Mata, and I don't think Santi is going to make it, but they're under 30. But at 34, I can't see Xavi being out there. He can't play consecutive games.
Well, but that's what I'm getting at. Engine room, right? The guys that really the brain of the operation.
I think you can throw on guys like Koke and Pedro to really add that bit of youth and those fresh legs. I mean, these guys have very high engines. And I would be very excited to see, you know, high impact sub like Koke come off the bench and, you know, fusing with Diego Costa. Very, very attractive. Again, I agree. It will be key also to put the sort of the Azpilicueta, Jordi Alba, to really have those guys coming up the flanks to put in the crosses. But we'll see. But moving on to the Netherlands, you know, this I think is a really interesting team. I think everyone had very high hopes for them, you know, going into the Euros last year, and it was quite a flop after the 2010 performance. Where do we think that they're going to finish, and how do you think their team is set up or not set up to succeed?
I believe that they have a lot of things working against them right now. I don't think they're gonna. I think this group. I think Chile is a tough team. I think Spain is gonna get out of this group, and I think Netherlands is gonna suffer. For one, I mean, a lot of people are building up their qualification run. They played Romania, Hungary, Turkey, Estonia, and Andorra. Was there any fear in any of those names? I mean, of course they should not lose a match to any one of those teams. Van Gaal is out. The players know he's out. He's got this tournament. They have historically, at least historically, a very selfish team. So every single player wants the ball at their feet and only at their feet. They're all individually world class. They're a very good and talented team. I just don't think they work well together. And I can't see the Netherlands invicting any sort of revenge on Spain. And I think Chile is going to be having home field advantage, quote unquote. And maybe, you know, they'll beat up on Australia. But I think that's about it.
Yeah. I'm a strong supporter of the Netherlands. I mean, I love their team. I think they always have the potential of winning every World Cup, you know, and, you know, as of recently. But the problem is they're catching their players on their kind of their downturn. You know, Van Persie is really the only key striker they have. You know, I think they pretty much, Huntelaar is good, but Van Persie is really the only key striker they have, and he's not in form right now. You know, we all know Schneider is a step slower. You know, yes, they have Robin, yes, they have De Jong, but they're just not the same players they used to be, or at least I haven't seen them play at that level they used to be at. So I think offensively they're going to be, you know, we're going to be looking for them to score a lot of goals and put in a lot of, you know, attacking press, but they won't be able to do that this World Cup.
Yeah. Well, and it's not so much, I agree, Shay, it's not so much the offense that I'm concerned about, but it really is that defense and in total in the team, I guess, sort of the lack of experience. You know, mm-hmm. the 21 of the 30 preliminary squad players, I believe 21 of the 30, yeah, have 15 or fewer caps for the national team. And then, you know, topping it off, you're going to have an inexperienced goalkeeper because Stekelenburg, you know, is left out of the squad after a dreadful season at Fulham. So it's not the offensive concerns, it's those defensive, it's really the sort of the players sort of removed from that defensive core from, mm-hmm. from previous years that has me the most concern. I think Strootman went down with an injury, and that really, I think, raises real questions for that back line to be exposed.
Just to build on that a little bit, who's the Van Bommel of this team?
who's the guy
that's gonna like pull this team up by the scruff of the neck when things get a little rough? I don't see it.
What do you think, Jay?
You know, it is that defense, and I do think, I mean, they're playing a five back formation, and all their defense except for one Premier League guy, they're all playing out of the Dutch league, which is the worst defensive league in the world, or, you know, for at least you know, watchable football.
Josie Astledor looks like Pele,
right? So I mean, Van Gaal recognized it. He throws five guys back there, and I was watching the Ecuador game a couple of days ago with Holland, and they weren't playing much, but Ecuador looked like, you know, they were just kind of keyed in the motion and kind of going with it, but they were getting behind that back line so easily. It ended 1-1, but that's only because there was a really just a quick strike deep in just basically Route 1 soccer. That was a quick strike from the half line to Van Persie's chest that they scored on. But I don't know. I really have no faith in this Netherlands team. If they go down 1-0 or 2-0 early against Spain, the whole tournament might fall apart.
Yeah, I completely agree. To go back to your question, Dan, though, I think you really have to look for Ronald Vlaar. Shout out to 7500 to Holt. I think he's had a really good season this year. Probably Aston Villa's player of the season in my mind. I think you're really gonna count on him for that key leadership. You know, yes, De Jong is there. You know, you have De Guzman, but I think it's really gonna start at the back. And if they're gonna have any chance of succeeding, he's gonna have to have a huge, huge tournament.
Australia.
It's a game of sharks and minnows, right? Fish off food, not friends.
Well, their coach has zero international experience, only has domestic, like A-League experience. The squad is majority in the mid-30s. They had a, you know, considerably, for world standards, an easy qualification.
Yeah, three of their eight wins in the final qualifying group, two of them were against Iraq. So, you know, not powerhouses of world football. But I don't mind so many players in the domestic league. It's something that I think, obviously, the U.S., I'm just looking at it through our lens, that the U.S. probably has to work on is developing the domestic league. Because if you look at a country like Mexico and you look at their roster, so many of those players are based in Mexico, or the general talent pool is mostly playing in the Mexican league, which means that, you know, it's easier to convene friendlies, to convene training camps. You get players playing together on a regular basis. So although the league is not great, I definitely see it having they could pull off some shock results. I mean, they still do have the experience paired with some of that youthful exuberance to make a bit of a difference. You know, point in case, Cahill.
The best header of the ball in Major League Soccer. The guy's like a magnet to the ball when it's in the air.
That's a dying breed of player.
He is. He's got a tenacity that's pretty much unrivaled, right? Some, you know, to a certain extent. So I agree that it is the World Cup also, and it is a tournament, so you do get to see some amazing things. But, you know, Spain, Chile, Netherlands, I think, are a class above Australia. It's just I can't spin it any other way.
So does anybody think that they're going to win a game or get a point?
I can see them maybe tying, but that's the most they're going to get.
Who are they going to tie?
That's the problem. I don't know.
they might tie Spain at the end. They play the last game.
They play the last game? Yeah. It's possible then. Yep. They play the last game June 23rd at noon. If Spain has it all locked up and they want to rest up for Croatia or Mexico.
Yeah, man, it's possible. It you know, doubtful, but I just it's sometimes such a shame you get a team like, you know, Australia, who I generally believe is sort of like an up-and-comer in world football. I think they kind of get written out because they sort of play, you know, they qualify out of the region they do. It's just such a shame that they're paired in this group, because I generally believe if they had, let's say, Korea or Japan, you know, those are types of teams we've seen in the previous World Cup that they can go out and get results against.
So they got to move to they got to apply to Asia.
They did. They're in Asia.
They're in Asia.
They are in Asia.
Oh, I'm sorry.
New Zealand is in Oceania.
I apologize for that.
But I mean,
that's okay. It just happened. Yeah, like two years ago.
Yeah, and once you're down there, I mean, you're so freaking far away that it's all the same. Oceania, you know, New Zealand, Australia. What's the difference?
Right. Now.
I am excited, though, to see Tom Rogic. I'm not sure if I said his name right, but he was the guy who came up from the Nike Academy. I don't know if you guys watched the YouTube clip, Nike Academy, where they played all the U teams from all around the world, and he's like 21 years old, and he came out of nowhere, and now he's like the star, and he's on the national team.
Is he from Celtic?
Yeah. I will be rooting for him, because I want to see him do some good things.
Yeah, for me, I want to see the Socceroos beat up on all these teams, but I don't know if that's going to happen. We breezed over Chile a little bit. I think Chile, is going to really. I mean, they're gonna. I think they're gonna win the group personally. I think they're gonna be able to pull off wins against both Spain and Netherlands. And I'm gonna say that Chile is my dark horse
to
win the group and to make it far. I don't think they're gonna win the World Cup, but Chile is my third horse in the race, I guess, so to speak.
Yeah.
That's a cool statement.
Yeah, I actually think that they're the favorite to win the group, actually. I think there's a lot of mutually assured destruction between Spain and Netherlands in that first game that I think really opens up the door for Chile. You like my cultured way of saying that. I'm not going to make the same mistake Dan made. So pedestrian. But really, I mean, oh. Oh, yes. Pardon me. my shit does not stink. No, I think, though, that the way, and we saw this in the Premier League, the sort of the pressing style is back. And, you know, Chile are going to play three at the back and really high up the pitch. And I think that's going to cause a lot of these teams a whole lot of problems. I mean, especially, you could say, a country like Netherlands. So if they get out, you know, by a couple goal lead, I think it's definitely doable.
I agree. Now, let's talk about individuals. Of these four teams, give me one guy that's going to surprise us.
I don't know. You know, in the World Cups, it's always the unlikeliest person, you know, who makes a name for themselves. You know, since we're all saying Chile is going to do well, I would probably say Vidal. Maybe the one guy who just has an amazing first round.
I'll let you think. I got one for you.
Well, that's tough because there's so many high-profile players in this group you know, that already have made a name for himself. So, yeah. so relatively, but I'm going to go look at a player like Koke. I really do. I think he's going to build off of a fabulous season at Atletico Madrid. And I think he's going to be that impact sub that comes off the bench. And I think really stretches teams for Spain to be that difference maker.
I think that's a good pick. I definitely think that Koke coming off the season is all the chips are in place for that to happen. My pick, and everyone should do themselves a favor and YouTube this guy when they get a chance. Charles Aragüez. He plays for Internacional in Brazil. Where
does he play? Say that again. I'm so turned on. Say it again. Where does he play?
He plays for Inter in Brazil.
No. How did you say it?
Internacional.
Brazil.
In Brazil. He's a Chilean. YouTube him. And then when the World Cup hits, you can tell all your friends that you knew about him before. The guy is, he's incredible. He's a great midfielder. He's doing really well for Inter. And it's a name like that that I think is, you know, every World Cup, there's a couple of these guys that they become, you know, I don't want to say household name because that's, but a soccer household name. And I think this guy is going to make his bones.
I was going to go with another Chilean in Vargas from Valencia. He plays up top with Sanchez in that system for Chile. And he's quietly getting, he was second or third in a team with goals. I think the second was, there was two guys with five. He had four goals during qualifying.
Yeah,
I think him and I think Lenz from Holland might also be another one playing up top with Van Persie.
Yeah, I expect Chile to go out and score a ton of goals. You know, they were only outscored by Argentina in the last round of qualifying. And they got some pretty big results under their belt. I think they beat England, drew Spain and Brazil in friendlies recently. So more power to them. I legitimately think that they could, and I've looked a little bit down the road, I think with favorable matchups and a little bit of help, I really think they could make it to the quarters.
I'm with you, but then they're going to lose.
Oh, yeah, no, of course.
Okay, let's put the magnifying glass to Group E. Group E has Ecuador, France, Switzerland, and Honduras. Now, there's a little bit of background to this group. I don't know if you guys are aware that so Europe qualifies 9 teams into the World Cup. And the old rule was that the 9th team in Europe, the 9th seeded team from Europe, would be put into the South American pot because they qualify less teams. And that team would have been France. So then France would have been potentially drawing up against all their European counterparts. However, 1 week before the draw, FIFA, in its grand wisdom and Franco-fileness, decided we'll do a random draw of the European teams to figure out who's going in pot two, because it's not fair to France. So the Italians got screwed, got put into pot two. We could talk about the Italian group, an arguable group of death, in a later episode. But the French get this group. And I think they're very, very, very lucky. Because this maybe should have been the Italians.
Yeah.
What do you guys think about my conspiracy theory? It's not really my conspiracy theory, but it actually happened. But
FIFA,
I don't know about the influence of the French on that or not.
No, it's pretty much not a conspiracy. Everybody knows that FIFA is the most corrupt institution in world sport. Like, worse than the IOC. Probably worse than most governments. I mean, if you had to rank like World Government Corruption Index and you counted FIFA, I'm pretty sure it'd be at the top. I mean, it's absurd. You know, you look at the whole Jack Warner scandal a couple years ago. So I'll let you infer whatever you want. But I think this really does. This is actually a bit trickier of a group than I think people otherwise would have thought.
I agree.
It is a, you know, obviously the France redemption story is written all over this group. And frankly, I'm just not very convinced at all.
Well, because there's two versions of France, right? There's 1998 and 2002, there's 1998 and 2006, and there's 2002 and 2010. 2002, they were miserable. 2010, they were miserable. The mutiny of 2010.
Yeah.
Well, Anelka didn't want to play, and all these other guys were against crazy Domenech or whatever his name was. Yeah. And then
let's hate on Man U for a second and just bring up the disgrace that is Patrice Evra.
Oh, Patrice Evra.
What about him? What do you have to say about him, Jacob? He's a leader.
A leader of mutinies. Seriously. But did he get a lifetime ban from the French team?
No, he's on this team.
He is on the squad?
Yeah, he's on the team. Yep.
He's on this team.
A complete abomination.
Anelka, I think, I don't know if he would have gotten a ban or if he just said, you know, he bit his thumb at them and said, I'm out. You know? F you, F you, you're cool, I'm out. Well, then, all right, so you're saying this is a little bit trickier.
Well,
tell me about Ecuador.
Well, you just got to say, number one, right off the bat with Ecuador, there's a huge hole left by the death of Christian Benitez, 27-year-old dying of heart attack. And it's a real heart-wrenching story, especially that, what's his face for Manchester United? God, I'm terrible with names.
Valencia.
Yes, Valencia and him are best buds, long-term childhood friends. So I think there's a lot of emotional drive there for Ecuador. That being said, you're looking to players like Jefferson Montero to really step up for them, and they have a tremendous what I think this group has a lot of. It's got a lot of pace, so I think there's a lot of opportunity there to exploit teams like Honduras, who are just going to get bashed and completely smashed, and then some of the younger teams like Switzerland, and I think they can definitely expose France.
Those are great points. I'm a strong supporter of all the South American teams this World Cup, because I mean, usually I wouldn't say it plays that big of a difference, the home continent, but I think it's gonna play in their favor highly. And they're a fast team, and this isn't their first rodeo, so they can. I think you underrated Honduras a little bit, Jacob, but I could potentially see Ecuador being the favorite out of this group.
I'm with you guys. I mean, I'm joking of that France got a lucky group, lucky draw. I think, however, Ecuador is going to struggle because Benitez was such a big part of the team. And after he passed away, they did struggle on the field. Mm-hmm. And they're very, very good going forward, but their goalkeeping and their defense has let them down at times. This is a little bit trickier. And like I had said in a previous episode, the groups where they kind of are not as attractive because they don't have the a lot of the star power, they're always the ones that have the excitement, because your expectations are so low that when you see something amazing, the Swiss can defend. They can defend very, very well. So they're going to make up a little bit of their inexperience going forward, because I think their forwards, their average age of their forwards is like 22. So they can make up with that with a pretty sturdy defense. And Honduras is extremely athletic team. Last World Cup, they only let up 3 goals. They didn't score any, so that's a problem. but we're looking at a couple of, so we're looking at kind of an interesting dynamic here. Switzerland and Honduras can probably defend very well. Ecuador looks very good going forward. France, if the right French team shows up, they could be very dynamic going forward. If the mutinous team shows up, it's going to be great for everybody. But if not, go ahead.
Well, one thing about this Ecuador team is they might be the most boring team within this group, because they're going to keep every game within 2-1, 1-1, 1-0 score lines. They haven't gotten blown out at all, and they haven't blown anybody out at all. And the one thing that scares me about them, from thinking of them going a little further, is they haven't won a single game on road qualifying. They've had 3 draws and 5 losses. They have 7 wins at home. So I don't know how they're going to be able to go on the road to go outside of the comfort zone in Ecuador, where they have the advantage of the altitude.
Yeah.
And be able to do something. Yeah, because they have, they didn't even play well in Peru, and Peru had the same altitude they have, and same thing with Bolivia, same altitude. So they weren't able to chew it on the road. So, I want to pick them, but I don't. I see other teams, as the other teams, they look more and more attractive.
Yeah, More troubling, I think, would be the three goals. I mean, we just got done kind of talking about Australia. I mean, they gave up three goals to an Australia side in March in a friendly. I don't think they'll really substantially challenge. And I just, you know, I wrote some notes on all the teams, and literally under Honduras, I don't have a single thing written. It's just not. I mean, there is Espinoza from Wigan. I mean, he's very, very promising. You know, we have an in-show producer making some suggestion. Figueroa. I mean, they got some players with experience. I just don't think this group particularly bodes well for them. But I'd like to kind of, you know, dive down on the microscope on France. And, you know, the notable exclusion of Samir Nasri, who was arguably probably too busy worrying about how Yaya Touré's feelings were and how underrated he felt and propping up his ego that he couldn't make the team. And worth mentioning that his girlfriend wrote that tweet to Deschamps, and now Deschamps is suing her for defamation.
Could you inform me on what she said?
I think she was like what bullshit, you know, I can't believe they, you know, he's shit, you know, Dominic is like a terrible coach. And he was just like, that's it, I'm not having it.
Only the French would sue over a tweet like that.
Yeah, it is. You're right. See, like Diadone and the Canal, like all that stuff's okay. We won't really try and stop it. But if you criticize us, we'll sue you.
Someone had mentioned to me, and I'm not sure if it was on a podcast or not. So if I did say it on a podcast already, I apologize. But someone had told me that Nasri is somewhat involved with the Canal thing. In some respects, in either in a previous tournament or some association, and they're kind of trying to break apart from that, and that's part of the reason why he got snubbed. Is that anyone else hear that, or is that just like rumor mill?
No, I've heard that as well. A lot of these French players are sort of tied into that that movement, and you know, buddies with Diadone. It's very odd though, considering you know his background, sort of you know Algerian born descent. It's a bit of a contradiction there, but you know nothing in France really makes sense from the American perspective. So, I don't know, perhaps our continental Spaniard can, continental European can give us some more insight.
Well, when you look at the team, you look at this lineup and you think to yourself, how does this team not go on to the next round? How does this team not do serious damage with the talent they have? But again, this is a team that went down, lost 2-0 in Uruguay. This is a team that got a 1-1 draw in Georgia, the country, not the state. This is they have talent everywhere and they just don't come together. And it's the complete opposite of somebody, you know, of like a great team. With no talent. Someone like, for example, Switzerland. No talent, but they end up getting number one seed.
Well, Ottmar Hitzfeld is a very good coach, experience. I think the Swiss are, I think, perennially underrated. But I think, you know, one of the more youthful teams in this group. I think only one player is going to be over the age of 30 come the World Cup. So I definitely wouldn't sell them short. But I guess you're right. When it comes down to the French team, it just comes down to attitude, work rate, and can they pull it all together? Yeah. I do think, though, that the midfield trio, and I'll agree with you, Jay, it's very hard to see them losing, but the midfield trio of Kabay, Matuidi, and Pogba is arguably, I think, the strongest midfield trio in the entire tournament. I think if we're looking for one player who's probably who I think could really blow up, it's by that supporting cast, it is Pogba.
For sure, definitely. I mean, I love Pogba because he played on Man U, period, but he really took that opportunity in Juventus and ran with it. I mean, he's showed himself all the talents he has and what he's capable of, and he's going to explode this World Cup, which is kind of the same reason why I, you know, when I think about it, just like you said, Jay, it's like ridiculous that you think that France can't make it through. And it really is, because if they play even remotely half as well as they need to, they will. And, you know, with Switzerland being this, this is a tougher group to call, because Switzerland, like as you said too, is a capable team.
If the egos are in place, if this team is playing how Giroud had said in the playoff, you know, this team would die to win. You know, like they gave everything against Ukraine. Then I think that they have the momentum completely in their side. Now, what happens if the team goes down? Do they have that willpower to fight back? I mean, It's strange because they have a couple of world class guys, winners, like proven winners on this team, but you have this sense that it's gonna happen again, you know. I feel like Kabai can have an explosive World Cup. I think he's in a prime position with that midfield that you guys explained. I think Pogba would almost essentially anchor that midfield and let Kabai be the one, the flair, and let him be the one that has the creativity and you know, that's always happens.
Yeah.
The one guy is really a rock and he gets no credit. And then the guy that makes that killer incision pass, he gets all the credit, but it's really the rock that made it happen.
Well, if that rock doesn't get some polishing and doesn't get some credit, I'm sure we'll have some locker room issues. The one kind of silver lining I thought is, and this maybe show you kind of the difference in coaching, you know, Raymond Dominic, it said, you know, used to use astrology and like, you know, numerology and all these kinds of weird mysticism to pick his teams. And then we just look at Deschamps, and I think he said, you know, Nasri is a terrific player, but and he kind of took a page out of Herb Brooks and the USA men's national 1980 hockey team and said, you know, it's not about having the best players, it's about having the right players. And I think that could be just a very telling, you know, way that the tide could slightly be shifting in their favor. But we'll see. With that, who from this group, as we said, for Group B, who is going to be your surprise player? And who do you think, because I think it's very possible, who do you think could be the most disappointing?
You know, it's going to be a little out there, and because I look at MLS a lot, and I follow the what's a qualifying on this end, but I think Jerry Benson is an absolute beast for his country. He doesn't do anything in MLS, and New England will love to sell him on a high. The guy scored 9 goals. I know it's CONCACAF, so there's nothing special. But the guy had 9 goals during for Honduras in qualifying. So I think if he could pull away, maybe one or two goals, you know, highlight goals, I think he would be the guy that's just going to lay up the world.
That's an interesting pick. I mean, they didn't score a goal last World Cup. So that's, I mean, that would be 200% more goals.
Yeah. Right. That's almost like sell high, buy low.
Go ahead.
And I guess the disappointment, you know, I just kind of think if Ecuador doesn't get past there, I think it's going to just be could be all on Valencia. I think he's going to have to deal with the brunt of it. And I'm not sure how that team's going to really play being away from home and out of the altitude with that advantage.
Yeah, certainly. What about Shay?
Well, I mean, and I know you guys might be like, this is not really that surprising, but I think the surprise, like, surprisingly good player is going to be Valencia. Because he doesn't play well for Man U. He just does what the coach requires of him. He's not a very exciting player. He gets kind of restrained. He was much more explosive on Wigan. And, you know, this is his time to kind of take that leadership role. And, you know, players like this, like, when they represent for their country and when they have the skill but they're kind of stifled, they show up in big moments like the World Cup. So I think Valencia is going to be the player who has an amazing World Cup. Everyone's going to be like, well, he represented for his team. He came out to play. And that's why I think Ecuador is going to be the second team to make it out of that group. And the player is going to be most disappointing. I mean, I don't – anyone from France, because I just don't think they're going to play that well.
No, yeah. Yeah, I tend to agree with that. I'm looking at this Switzerland team, and since it's so young, there's so many good players. Again, just talking about strong center midfields, that Napoli trio of Brahmi, Desmali, and Gohan Inler I think are pretty impressive. I just think they're going to allow Shaqiri to really shine. You know, he's kind of been a bit bottled at Bayern after being, you know, let loose off the leash onto the European stage with FC Basel. So I think he's one to watch. And I think you have, you know, Xhaka, who will also be, I think, a pleasant surprise. But if we're looking at disappointments, I'm also going to look on the Swiss team and just look at the I think he sometimes get a bad rap, and I actually have an autographed jersey of his. And Dan, you'll know who I'm talking about, but definitely a Philip Senderos. You know,
I knew,
like,
you were going to say
there's
it.
Like good Philip Senderos,
I knew it.
Bad Philip Senderos. It's like two faces. You know, you just don't know what you're going to get. But
his head spins completely around.
It's true, but he's got an impeccable, you know, record for that team, and so he can either be capable of great feats, or, you know, my family knows, and I've seen him play in person. calamitous errors. I mean, he's almost on par with, I think, like Kolo Touré in terms of like overall goofiness.
Just how many mistakes they make, you mean?
Yeah, you just, you know, everything's going great, and then it's just like, oh, wow, the ball just ended up in the back of our net.
You took a little bit the wind out of my sails, because I agree with you 100%, Shaqiri. I think he has been a bit, he's become a bit of a bit player at Bayern, and I think this is a showcase for him to really shine, and maybe put a little pressure to either get a little bit more playing time at Bayern or go make a better paycheck somewhere else. You know what I mean? Disappointment. I'm kind of with Shay. I feel like it's going to be a Frenchman. My gut is telling me that Ribéry is going to. He's not. Yeah. He hasn't been since the end of the season, since winning the league, and that injury that he took midway through Champions League. He's just not been the same Ribéry that was in contention for Player of the Year. And I think when you look at it, I mean, I think even Ribéry on a downswing is still going to be a great player. But I think the expectation of what we would want to see out of him, we're not going to see. And take that to the bank.
Yeah, definitely. All right. Very quickly now, who do we think is going to go 1-1-2?
I'm going to go with France and Sweden purely on goal differential.
Switzerland.
I'm sorry. Switzerland.
We all do wish.
I wish it was Sweden.
Wish Zlatan was here. Better. Yeah.
No, France and Sweden on a goal differential. Switzerland. Say it again.
Sorry.
you've got Zlatan on the brain.
I do. Oh, yeah. It's just not a World Cup without him.
Well, Zlatan has Zlatan on his brain.
Yeah.
I'm going to stick with Ecuador and France. Although, you know, if you asked me to wager on it, I would pass. You know, like this is a tough one. I think, again, the bipolar French. If 1998 French show up, 2006 French show up, okay, we're talking. 2002, 2010, they're a bust.
I still think though Switzerland really are going to finish first. That defensive record. I don't remember. Was it Euro 2008 or was it 2010 when they played Spain? I think, weren't they the only team to score?
Last World Cup,
right. So I think that defensive fortitude will do them well. Experience. I'm absolutely in love with Otmar Hitzfeld. Actually, regrettable that he's going to retire after the World Cup. And then I think France is going to finish second. I really do. And I'm looking at just the sumptuous matchup. I'm salivating here of the prospect of maybe France playing Argentina in a second round matchup.
I think it's I agree with you, Jacob. I think it's Switzerland 1 and France 2.
All right. With that, we have a in studio guest. What up, Chris? Hit us with the wild card. $50, and Chris, you want to match me on another 50?
Go 100. No,
100 on the whole season that Liverpool will finish higher than Arsenal next season.
I'm not betting that. If Arsenal spends £100 million on transfers, I can't bet that.
They're not going to spend. Yeah, they're going to spend £100 million on all center attacking midfielders.
Dan,
watch me.
Dan, do you think it's possible that you guys spend £100 million this summer?
Yes.
I do too.
The problem is the World Cup can totally kill it, though.
Originally, this item was used to summon distant villagers to attend community gatherings. The Vuvuzela is what I'm referring to. Became very popular in the World Cup in 2010. A study in 2010 actually found that tiny droplets at the bottom of the Vuvuzela can carry flu and cold germs that are small enough to stay suspended in the air for hours, worse than coughing or shouting. Actually, Liverpool and Arsenal have banned it from their stadiums because of health concerns, banned from a bunch of venues, Wembley, Yankee Stadium, NFL games, Wimbledon, etc. What is this World Cup's Vuvuzela this year? What will it be?
Well, for one, I'm just going to say that you can have studies say whatever you want. And if I was one of those teams, I would also make a false statement that said that the Vuvuzela causes disease.
All my sourcing is from Wikipedia, so I
that's fine. It might actually be a real study, but I would fake one. It's just awful. It's just awful. It sounds like you're watching a soccer match and there's bees surrounding the stadium. I think for everyone except for Brazilians, it will be the samba drums. And ooh, we were going to love it all the way to the final, and you guys are going to hate it.
No, you know what's going to end up happening is you're going to, this is probably the thing I hate most about the MLS, but you're going to have some Americans down there, some Yanks, yanking some of those Brazilian traditions, and then they're going to show up in the MLS stadiums. I actually don't mind the Vuvuzela. I think it's, you know, or like the music, the constant cacophony, I think it sort of enhances it. And if you listen back to like some of the recordings or videos from the World Cup in Mexico, some of the crowd noises and the sound, it's like a swarm of bees. It's almost, for me, it's like I think that a lot of these cultures are very sound driven, that it almost defines the World Cup. So I look forward to it.
I think it'll be, I'm not sure where they are, you guys. They have like beads on the outside of them.
Oh, you mean like one of those things that you twist in your hand?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. It's just a Karate Kid.
It's not a Morocco, but it's got those metal beads and you twist it in your hands.
Is it like a maraca with like beads though?
Exactly. Similar, exactly. Yeah. I think that's exactly what I was looking for.
I know it's not going to happen, but it's perfect for probably the atmosphere you're going to go into. But the capoeira berry bow, which is basically a big stick with a rattle at the end and a metal string, like a piano wire at the end of it.
Banana way, banana way, banana. Yeah, that one?
That one, yep, only the strong.
That song is the instrument? Is that what I'm led to believe?
Well, if you had to, you have to play the instrument in there, but there's like a little dun 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 dun.
It's basically a bow with a piano string on it.
Well, thanks everybody for tuning in. This has been a great podcast, some fun musings. Looking forward to podcasting with you more throughout the summer and catching up on some of these quarterfinal, final, and end of group match reports. Check us out on social media, Zoom, Marketplace, Twitter, at ATP Radio, at Soccer Yanks. Also, check us out on our website for Eyes on Rio, which is socceryanks.com/Eyes on Rio. And please look in the crowd for some Soccer Yanks and ATP members who may be at some of these World Cup games. And look out for some beautiful people on the prowl. Thanks for tuning in. Did I encapsulate everything you wanted to do? Dan, did that please do?
That was perfect, especially the beautiful people.
Especially Zoom Marketplace.
Zoom, whatever.